is that time of the year. It is Valentine's Day is this week. And so once a year, I think it's valuable for us to talk about marriage and the relationship that marriage has and what we should do in relationship with our spouses. The fact is that marriage is something we have to work at. Marriage is so important. It is critical, literally, to our community and to what happens in our world. This history has proven that if you destroy marriage, you'll destroy a culture. And we'll talk about that a little bit further in just a minute. I just want to say this, that what I'm saying about marriage, really, if you think about it, touches on all relationships. There's two words we're going to be using today, love and respect. Men are told to love their wives, to love their wives like Christ loved the church. How did Christ love the church? He sacrificed himself on the cross. That's love. Men are told to love their wives that way. Women are commanded a similar command. Men, you're commanded to love. Women, you're commanded to respect, to show respect to your spouse. Now think about all of our relationships really require these two things, don't they? Your best relationships, no matter who they're with, it could be your neighbor. If you don't love them, how's the relationship going to go? If you don't respect them, their boundaries, their property line right here in Crestline, okay? If you don't respect and love really are part of all relationships. So while I'm especially looking at marriages today, I just want you to think about this fact that if you're single, this speaks to you. If you've never been married and never want to be married and hope you never get tempted to be married, it still speaks to you because we still live in a world with people around us. If you're in a family, it speaks to you. Brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, grandparents, and on. We are in relationships with one another. In fact, when I was looking at this and thinking about it, I came to the passage in Mark chapter 10. By the way, for those of you who are reading through the Bible this year, we read Mark 10 this morning, didn't we? And it's interesting. If you look at Mark 10, inside of Mark 10, Jesus is being asked by the Pharisees. They come to him. They're trying to trap him. And so they think they've got a tough question for him. And so they say, Jesus, you know, and they question him about divorce. They came and they test him by asking, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Now, it's interesting how Jesus responds. He says, what did Moses command you? Now, listen carefully to their answer. They said, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. What did Moses command? He didn't command for there to be divorce, did he? They understand they're about to get trapped. They don't realize it. They understand that Moses permitted something. But what was Moses' command? Now that's different. So Jesus responds, Moses permitted a man to write a certificate of divorce and send her away. It was because your hearts were hard that Moses wrote this law, Jesus said. But at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. And what's interesting is, just a few moments later, a young man, a rich young man, comes up to Jesus and says, good teacher, What do I need to do to inherit eternal life? Now, we're not going to do much with that question, but just think about it for a second. What do I have to do to inherit? He's rich. That means he's already inherited his wealth, hasn't he? He's already had it passed on to him. So now he's looking for the same thing. How do I inherit? Well, Jesus is going to have a different answer for him. And he says, and he asks him, you know, well, tell me about the commands. How have you done at, and he will go through the relational commands. What are the relational commands? They're the second six of the commands. The first four are about our relationship with God. The second six are all about our relationships with one another. Don't steal, don't covet, don't bear false testimony. Those commands that relate to relationships. And how did Jesus summarize all those six? Love one another. So while I'm talking about marriage today, I'm talking about us loving one another and a responsibility that we have to love one another. I'm also talking about respecting one another and a responsibility that we have to show respect to all people around us. And sometimes that's challenging, isn't it? Jimmy Evans has a website and a ministry called Marriage Today. I encourage some of you, if you want resources for your marriage, to look at this. And he wrote about the world-changing power of marriage. He said, marriage is the most important institution in society. It's the foundation, and no society can remain strong without the underlying strength of marriage in the culture around it. And then he goes back to 1947. Get this. That, were you here then? 1947, Harvard sociologist Carl Zimmerman showed that great nations never rise from weak marriages and families. He discovered 8 traits that all doomed empires of the past in common. You might say, well, that's so long ago, it's probably not true. Oh, no. He was looking at cultures hundreds of years prior. And look at these items. Number one, marriage loses its sacredness as it is frequently broken by divorce. Number two, the traditional meaning of marriage is watered down or completely lost. Number three, women lose their inclination for childbearing and rearing, and the birth rate decreases. Number four, there is an increased public disrespect for parents. Number five, there is an increase in juvenile delinquency, promiscuity, and rebellion. Six, hostility towards the traditional family spreads throughout society. Seven, there is an increased acceptance of adultery. And eight, there is a tolerance for sexual perversions of all kinds. And now, though he wrote that in 1947, does that sound like any other time? The text we're going to look at this morning is from Ephesians chapter 5, the latter part of that chapter, verses 28 to 33. In it, Paul writes this, "In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body, the body of Christ. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but Paul says, I'm talking about Christ and the church. This mystery that we are one with God, that there's the body here, that represented by those of us in this room who know Jesus Christ, that we are one with God, that we have this unit with him, is a mystery that's just incredible. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself. And the wife must respect her husband. You must love your wife. Does it sound optional, gentlemen? You must love your wife. Galatians 5:14, the entire law is summed up in a single command. Love your neighbor as yourself. 1 Corinthians 13:2. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I have nothing. The context of 1 Corinthians is it's right in the middle, 1 Corinthians 13, right in the middle between 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 14. Isn't that interesting? Yeah, you find 1 Corinthians 13 right in the middle. What's in 1 Corinthians 12? In 1 Corinthians 12, Paul's talking about the body and the gifts of the Spirit that are given to the body of Christ. he then says, okay, here's the most excellent way, and he gives us a definition of love, describes that for us in 1 Corinthians 13. Then he comes back to talking about the body again and us using all of our different gifts to build up the body. And the unity of the body of Christ, this mystery that he has seen in Ephesians, is what he's describing in these three chapters, 1 Corinthians 12, 13, and 14. And he says, if you don't have love, you've got nothing. And again, do you have to be married to love other people? No. You can be living totally alone, but you still have got to learn to love other people. And wherever you're at, we have to make a commitment, and we have this responsibility. We must love one another. Men, if you're married, you must love your wife. By the way, I just got to take a quick pause on that one. Whenever we get a commandment from God, God also gives us the ability to meet that commandment, to do what is required of us. If love was simply an emotion, can you force yourself to have an emotion? Well, you might be able to get yourself to get ticked off real easy, okay, right? But can you really, feel wonderful love for somebody else? No, it doesn't happen that way, does it? It comes by action. But when you commit yourself to doing, you see, I really appreciate what Father John Powell said in his book on love. He said that love is a decision. That was the title of the book. It's a decision that we make. And I'm just going to have to tell you straight away that, and I understand some of you have probably gone through the pain of divorce. And if you have, then you know that divorce hurts. I haven't met a single person that's going through divorce and said, it's the most wonderful thing I've ever experienced. Now, oftentimes there can be all kinds of reasons why a person gets divorced, and we're not trying to attack anybody right now. But anyone who's been divorced understands that there's pain that goes with that, and God is not wanting us to experience that pain. Now, if there's pain in the marriage, if there's adultery and things like that, and there's abuse, God doesn't want that either. Okay, So, and I'm not trying to cover every detail of every sin and every problem in every marriage. I just want us to understand, though, that love is a decision. Love is a commitment that we make, and it doesn't necessarily come because we feel like it. But as we do it, love grows. And so God gives us a command, and he says, gentlemen, you must love your wife. Well, I got thinking, okay, well, let's talk a little bit about what that means. And that's why I looked to 1 Corinthians 13. The first one we're going to ignore because it says love is patient, and I don't have it, so we're going to go on. Love is kind. No, the first one is, why did God have to do this? He starts out with the one that's toughest for some of us, especially us guys, right? Come on. How many of us men are impatient with things? The wife asks you a question, and you're, I wanted to answer that. Especially if it's a why question. Come on, guys, help me here. Love is patient. Love has a long mind. Chrysostom said that it's the word used of the man who is wronged and who has it easily in his power to avenge himself, and yet he will not do it. Some of us have been told, count to 10. Some of us need to count to 1,000. So this morning, we didn't have anybody to do the coffee down at the coffee shop, and I didn't know that until we get over here. I'm like, nobody do the coffee. Now, some of you know the pastor wants us to do our coffee down at the coffee shop every Sunday, right? But some of you also know that pastor's wife is such a servant that if you come in here and don't have coffee, what's she going to do for you? She's going to get you coffee. Last couple weeks because pastor's been saying no coffee over there, no goodies over there, right? But pastor's wife doesn't want to see any of you coming in here not having your caffeine fix. And so she's trying to help you with your addiction. So we get in here this morning, and I said, we don't have anyone down there. So she says, you know, well, okay, and we're just not going to worry about it today. Yes. Good. It's going to be a teaching time. It'll be an opportunity for the church to learn that we need other people to volunteer to help with a coffee. Right? Be an opportunity to learn that it's not all on Debbie's job. It's not all Debbie's job or ours. And so, good. Good. Teaching time. Bill, I don't think we should do that. And it turns into the one of those, love is patient? No, I was not patient. No, we're not going to do that. Guess who won? I called the Baileys and asked them if they would volunteer, right, Mary and Jeff? Could you guys get over here quick? We need somebody down here. Because I don't want to do that, but I'm losing with my wife. I don't know about you guys, but are you ever impatient with your wife? I am. And I was this morning. And why am I saying that? Because, guys, we all need to realize that we're all imperfect. We all have to work at this. Don't put anyone else up on a pedestal. We're all trying to learn how to love and follow this command to love our wives. Love is patient. Love is kind. It's tender and compassionate and gentle. Love does not envy. It doesn't grieve the other person. It's not grieved because something good is happening for them. In fact, it rejoices that she's being blessed, and you want her to be blessed. Love does not boast. It's not prideful and speaking all about me, and look at me, and look at all the things that I've done, and come on, applaud me. And when you come home there, it's applauding her. The real lover cannot get over the wonder that he is loved. Boy, I'm still amazed by that fact that Debbie, that God loves me. Love does not dishonor others. And by the way, there's another one there. Love is not proud, not inflated with your own self-importance. And we're going to come back to that near the end of the message. Love does not dishonor others by being rude, brutish, focused on yourself. Love does not behave gracelessly. It's a significant fact that in Greek the words for grace and for charm are the same. There's a graciousness in Christian love which never forgets that courtesy and tact and politeness are lovely things. I enjoy opening the door for Debbie. And there's a grace that we ought to show our wives. Love is not self-seeking. It doesn't insist on its own way. I have to win at all costs. Love does not do that. Those who insist upon their privileges and those who always remember their responsibilities are not those who are always thinking of what life owes them and those who never forget what they owe to life. That is not love. Love is not easily angered. Some of us have a temper we have to watch for. It doesn't rage, though. It doesn't explode in anger. Love says, no, I'm going to stop this emotion. I'm going to stop this engine because I love this person. Love keeps no record of wrongs, which is such a dangerous thing. We track what somebody else has done to us, said to us. We remember that. Wives are sometimes good about pointing out those things that we've done in the past. Men can do that same thing, and yet love keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, takes no pleasure in another person's misfortune. And love rejoices with the truth. Truth is sometimes challenging, isn't it? To be truthful is one of the things that builds a relationship, to be honest. And one of the things that we have to do is celebrate the truth of Jesus Christ and not, see, I was right. Yeah, that's not truth in love, I'm sorry. Love always protects. Doesn't talk about the shortcomings of the other person and attempting to demean them and pull them down. Holds them in high regard. Love always trusts. It believes in the good of your wife. Love always hopes, believing something good will happen for you and with you and for her. And love always perseveres. It doesn't give up. It doesn't, it, it, it endures, it transforms, it makes a difference in the relationship, because it's not, love is not going to quit. Gentlemen, do you love your wife? In 1 Corinthians 13 has incredible instructions for you to work on. And then finally, verses 8 to 10, it says, love never fails. Where there are prophecies, they will cause, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when completeness comes, what is in part disappears. Because love, love is complete. Love, God's love. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. That's not true. Come on, boys. For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror, then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. You see, love recognizes there's more to know. That special lady you committed your life to, and who committed their life to you, she's changed. She doesn't look the same as when you married her. Newsflash, neither do you. But she is more special today if you will get to know her. She has more gifts today than the day you married her. She has more special things about her, more insights, more wisdom, more love than the day you met her. See, I got to know God years ago. But I'm still getting to know him more and more. And 43 years ago this last week, I committed my life in a church like this to a beautiful bride. But I'm still getting to know more of the treasure that God has created in that lady. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Love, unconditional, sacrificial. Love, it's the greatest. And we are called to love how? Like Christ loved us. We're supposed to love the way he gave to us. He gave unconditionally. He gave when we didn't deserve it. He gave even when we were opposed to him. He gave. And we are supposed to love like that. In fact, we're supposed to also love like the way you care about yourself. You care about yourself, your own life? Love your wife that way. And love, leaving all else, love her. The measure of greatness is not, does anybody love me? And then we kind of, and by the way, girls, you've been listening to this, but did you remember that love is your responsibility too? Okay. And single people, you've been listening to this, but did you remember that even if you're not married, you're long ways from marriage, you're still supposed to love? Too many people are asking the question, does anybody love me? You're asking the wrong question. The question you should be asking is, does anybody feel loved by me? Am I a loving person? Not, am I receiving love? But do I give love? Because love is a commandment. All right, gentlemen, you're off the hot seat for a few moments, but don't forget, respect and submission are your responsibility as well. Ladies, the wife must respect her husband. You need to make submission a lifestyle. Now, I've used that word already. To submit means to respect. True submission, by the way, is voluntary. It's not something that can be forced upon you, even though God commands it, right? And ladies, you're commanded to respect just like the men are commanded to love. Respect your husband. Spirit-filled believers are to continually, voluntarily place themselves under the authority of one another. Don't you do that? Come up to a signal that's not working and a policeman's out there in the middle of the road, and what do? You say there's nobody, you say that's a policeman out there, he's not a red light, and I can do whatever I want to do, right? Not too smart, I'm just telling you. Henry Alford says, subjecting oneself to another is the opposite of self-assertion. the opposite of an independent autocratic spirit. It's the desire to get along with one another, being satisfied with less than one's due, a sweet reasonableness of attitude. Jesus said, for whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it. You want to really live the way God wants you to, you learn to give of yourself. I like what 1 Peter said, chapter 3, verse 1. I'm reading from the New Living. In the same way, you wives must accept the authority of your husbands. Now, that kind of sounds like, you know, tyrant doesn't matter. Do what the tyrant says, right? Well, keep listening. Then even if some refuse to obey the good news, your godly lives will speak to them without any words. They will be won over by observing your pure and reverent lives. Don't be concerned about the outward beauty of fancy hairstyles, expensive jewelry, or beautiful clothes. You should clothe yourselves instead with the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God. Pritchard said, submission is first and foremost an attitude of the heart. Submission is about God. And until we grasp it, we continue to struggle in this area. Until we get a hold of it, that submission is about God, not about that other person, we're going to have a problem. Two simple questions for you. Do you believe God is in control of your life down to the tiny details? Do you believe God has you where he wants you to be right now? See, if you can answer yes to those questions, then you learn to submit to authority in your life. And until you can answer yes, you will struggle with this area. Here's the bottom line of submission. Live for God. Show respect to other people. Live for God. Oswald Chambers, in his book, My Utmost for His Highest, often includes a three-word phrase near the end of his letters. He writes this little phrase, be absolutely his. Be absolutely his. Be absolutely God's. Live for God. Be absolutely his at home, not yours, his. Be absolutely his at church, not yours, his. Be absolutely his on the job, not yours, his. Be absolutely his in the classroom, and be absolutely his in every relationship. Incidentally, in the end, submission is not about you obeying someone else or about you following a set of rules. Submission is a spiritual issue between you and God. And it touches every part of life because behind every human authority stands incidentally, submission is about two equals, not one better than the other. Need I take you back to a verse that we moved way past? And it's in verse 21. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. The triangle of marriage is a man and a woman who are equal, submitting to each other out of their reverence, their mutual submission to Jesus Christ. And one of the things that I'm learning about is as I submit and respect Debbie, what am I also doing? I'm respecting and submitting to Christ. And the same thing is true, ladies. Wayne Barber notes in context of marriage, hupotasso, this word for submission, doesn't mean that the wife is commanded to obey her husband as a child would obey his parents or a slave would obey his master. A lot of men treat their wives, guys, I'm sorry, this one's about you, as if they are a doormat. They walk all over them as if they have no sense, as if they have no ability, as if they are inferiors. And that's not what submission means. Dr. Barber goes on to explain that hupotasso, the word used for wives to husbands, is the word that talks about two people who are absolutely equal in God's eyes, totally equal. There's not one level of inferiority of one to the other. But the wife makes a choice to place herself as an equal underneath another, equal her husband, in order that there can be order and function in the family. The whole purpose of it is so that it meets the design that God has already ordered. Does it mean that your wife is a slave to obey your every command? some of you wish that were. Does it mean that you treat her like a child? No. If there is a man who thinks for one second that they have any superiority in God's eyes over their wife, they are gravely mistaken from God's word. However, by his design to have a functional family, concessions have to be made. So God says, wives, you make it and you choose to put yourself underneath the head of your husband in order that the design can be what God says it ought to be. The meaning of it has nothing to do with inferiority or superiority. It takes nothing from the dignity of a woman for her to submit, but rather it enhances. It takes great integrity for a person to do what God says should be done. That's an excerpt from Dr. Barber's book, Spirit-Filled Families. My right and my left hand are as opposite as Debbie and I. Sometimes we can clash. Yes, we may have different opinions about who gets coffee on Sunday morning. Husbands, love your wife the way Christ loved the church. How did he do it? He gave himself as a sacrifice for her. So husbands, love your wives. Wives, be submissive. Show respect to your husbands, for this is fitting for you in the Lord. Together, what are we doing? Did you see it? Aren't we both taking a role of serving and valuing the other person? Love and respect. Do you know what the problem is, though? And it really is at the heart of so many relationships and why so many relationships break, whatever they might be. A neighbor you're not getting along with, a co-worker you dislike. At the heart of it, do you want to know? It's in one word. The problem is self-centeredness. And now I want to quote some things from Rick Warren. He says, what's the real problem in our relationships? When you boil it all down, the root of every problem is self-centeredness. It's at the root behind every conflict, behind every argument, behind every relational strain. It is self-centeredness. James 4, 1 and 2. Do you know where your fights and arguments come from? They come from the selfish desires that war within you. You want things, but you do not have them, so you argue and you fight. Do you want better relationships with the people around you, with your spouse, with your neighbors, with your co-workers, with your friends, with your family? If you do, then you're going to have to ask God for a deeper awareness of your own self-centeredness. Yes, the Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if you really want better relationships with the people around you, then start confessing that you are self-centered. Ask God, show me this week how self-centeredness stains my life. By the way, that's a prayer for you. You're not praying that for me. Incidentally, in the New Living Translation, Galatians 5, 19 to 21, says that there's basically 15 words that kind of visualize for us selfishness, self-centeredness. The wrong things the sinful self does are clear. Being sexually unfaithful. Surely infidelity is built on self-centeredness and it'll ruin almost any marriage. What's it saying? Well, I don't care what happens to anyone else. I'm going to do what makes me feel good. I'm going to do what pleases me. And I got to tell you that most adulterous relationships at some point will also have some thought about murder. Because you want the other person to die so they can get out of the way. Self-centeredness. He goes on. So being sexually unfaithful, hating, making trouble, being jealous. jealous, being angry, being selfish, making people angry with each other, causing divisions among people, feeling envy, being drunk, and doing other things like these. These are all expressions of self-centeredness. So what are you going to do? Because if you're really honest today, if you really admit it, every single one of us is self-centered. Number one, admit it. Begins there. Admit your self-centeredness. Admit what's inside of you. No punching elbows here, no kicking knees, moving ankles. Admit your self-centeredness. Number two, focus more on the hope of heaven. What? Yeah, think more about this fact. You're only here for a short time. Heaven is an eternity. Get ready to spend eternity with the people around you. Quit thinking about what you need. Think about what you can do for eternity, what you can do to get ready to be in heaven, what you can do to get ready to enjoy all of what God has for you. Focus on heaven. Admit your selfishness. Focus more on the hope of heaven. And thirdly, face your disappointments. Some of you are disappointed with decisions you've made. Some of you are disappointed with the decisions that your spouse makes. Some of you are disappointed with things that have happened. Some of you are disappointed with your kids. They haven't turned out the way you wanted. Some of you are disappointed with the dreams you had for your life. Face your disappointments. Some of you are saying, I deserve better than this. Things should have gone better than they did. I don't deserve to have had what happened to me. I deserve somebody better than you in my life. There, you're in trouble, huh? Why? Because at the heart of that is because I'm better. I deserve it. Face your disappointments. Because at the heart of your disappointments is your own self-centeredness. As long as you're looking to other people to meet your need, you're going to be disappointed. As long as you're trying to make other people serve you, be your God, you're going to be disappointed. Is only God can meet our needs. And by the way, disappointment is saying, you let me down. If you're disappointed in your spouse, you're saying, you let me down. If you're disappointed in God, you're saying, you let me down. Face your disappointments. Let's pray. God, there's not a person in this room that is perfect in our relationships. Every single one of us is vulnerable to self-centeredness. We live with ourselves every day. And we have all of our needs and our desires and our thoughts and our feelings and our frustrations and our emotions and our stresses. And we're carrying those around every day. And then we run into this other person and we're supposed to love them or we're supposed to respect them. Lord God, help us. Help us to admit our self-centeredness and that it's in the way of our relationships. Forgive us, Lord. Cleanse us. You promised to do that. So do that for us today. Lord, I pray for the marriages represented in this room. Every one of them is under spiritual attack. I'm not surprised, God, because you said wherever two or more of you are gathered together and agree about anything, and they ask it, I will do it. And Satan knows that every marriage is potentially one of those powerful weapons that you will respond to because they would agree. And evil doesn't want us to be in unity, doesn't want us to be in agreement. Wants our marriages to be broken up, wants our families to be destroyed. Evil wants that. So I pray for every marriage here that each one that's represented, whether their spouse is here today or not, that they would remember to love and to show respect, to live for you, God, to allow you to live through them, and to recognize that there are forces of darkness, serious forces of darkness that want to ruin their relationship. And that is true for all of us, God. all of our relationships. Evil does not want us to unite. Evil does not want us to come together. Evil does not want us to love one another. So, Lord, forgive us when our self-centeredness gets in the way, when our hunger for success, our desires, our passions, all the things we want get in the way of us loving others like you loved us. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to remember how much you sacrificed because you love us. So, Lord, bless the marriages. Strengthen them again this day. And bless each person here with a new love for people around them. In Jesus' name, amen. If the worship team would please come. In the bulletin this morning is a sheet that has a place for you to write your name. It's also a place there for you to write your prayer requests. A place for you to allow us to pray for you. This would be a great time for you to say, pray for my marriage. Don't worry, we're not going to lift that up as a note and say, see, I knew this marriage was in trouble. Because every marriage represented in this room needs prayer. But share with us. Let us pray more specifically for you, please. Please. Yesers will receive our offerings. One of the best offerings you can put in that plate is your prayer need. Team ready? Please. Ushers, please come. And there is application for your marriages there, ladies and gentlemen. Love her. Respect him. It's a command. And enjoy the blessing of lighting a fire again in your marriages. And by the way, if you haven't been romantic lately, figure out a way to do it this week. God bless you. If you do, then you're going to have to ask God for a deeper awareness of your own self-centeredness. Yes, the Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And if you really want better relationships with the people around you, then start confessing that you are self-centered. Ask God, show me this week how self-centeredness stains my life. By the way, that's a prayer for you. You're not praying that for me. Incidentally, in the New Living Translation, Galatians 5:19-21 says that there's basically 15 words that kind of visualize for us selfishness, self-centeredness. The wrong things the sinful self does are clear. Being sexually unfaithful. Surely infidelity is built on self-centeredness and it'll ruin almost any marriage. What's it saying? I don't care what happens to anyone else. I'm going to do what makes me feel good. I'm going to do what pleases me. And I got to tell you that most adulterous relationships at some point will also have some thought about murder. That you want the other person to die so they can get out of the way. Self-centeredness. He goes on. Being sexually unfaithful, hating, making trouble, being jealous, being angry, being selfish, making people angry with each other, causing divisions among people, feeling envy, being drunk, and doing other things like these. These are all expressions of self-centeredness. So what are you going to do? Because if you're really honest today, if you really admit it, every single one of us is self-centered. Number one, admit it. Begins there. Admit your self-centeredness. Admit what's inside of you. No punching elbows here, no kicking knees. Admit your self-centeredness. Number two, focus more on the hope of heaven. What? Yeah, think more about this fact. You're only here for a short time. Heaven is an eternity. Get ready to spend eternity with people around you. Quit thinking about what you need. Think about what you can do for eternity, what you can do to get ready to be in heaven, what you can do to get ready to enjoy all of what God has for you. Focus on heaven. Admit your selfishness, focus more on the hope of heaven. And thirdly, face your disappointments. Some of you are disappointed with decisions you've made. Some of you are disappointed with the decisions that your spouse makes. Some of you are disappointed with things that have happened. Some of you are disappointed with your kids. They haven't turned out the way you wanted. Some of you are disappointed with the dreams you had for your life. Face your disappointments. Some of you are saying, I deserve better than this. Things should have gone better than they did. I don't deserve to have had what happened to me. I deserve somebody better than you in my life. There you're in trouble, huh? Why? Because at the heart of that is because I'm better. I deserve it. Face your disappointments. Because at the heart of your disappointments is your own self-centeredness. As long as you're looking to other people to meet your need, you're going to be disappointed. As long as you're trying to make other people serve you, be your God, you're going to be disappointed. Is only God can meet our needs. And by the way, disappointment is saying, you let me down. If you're disappointed in your spouse, you're saying, you let me down. If you're disappointed in God, you're saying, you let me down. Face your disappointments. Let's pray. God, there's not a person in this room that is perfect in our relationships. Every single one of us is vulnerable to self-centeredness. We live with ourselves every day. And we have all of our needs and our desires and our thoughts and our feelings and our frustrations and our emotions and our stresses. And we're carrying those around every day. And then we run into this other person and we're supposed to love them or we're supposed to respect them. Lord God, help us. Help us to admit our self-centeredness and that it's in the way of our relationships. Forgive us, Lord. Cleanse us. You promised to do that. So do that for us today. Lord, I pray for the marriages represented in this room. Every one of them is under spiritual attack. I'm not surprised, God, because you said wherever two or more of you are gathered together and agree about anything, and they ask it, I will do it. And Satan knows that every marriage is potentially one of those powerful weapons that you will respond to because they would agree. And evil doesn't want us to be in unity, doesn't want us to be in agreement, wants our marriages to be broken up, wants our families to be destroyed. Evil wants that. So I pray for every marriage here that each one that's represented, and whether their spouse is here today or not, that they would remember to love and to show respect, to live for you, God, to allow you to live through them, and to recognize that there are forces of darkness, serious forces of darkness that want to ruin their relationships. And that is true for all of us, God, in all of our relationships. Evil does not want us to unite. Evil does not want us to come together. Evil does not want us to love one another. So Lord, forgive us when our self-centeredness gets in the way, when our hunger for success, our desires, our passions, all the things we want get in the way of us loving others like you loved us. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to remember how much you sacrificed because you love us. So Lord, bless the marriages. Strengthen them again this day. And bless each person here with a new love for people around them.